Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. I think we're about ready to begin. We'll give everybody a chance to find a seat. I'm delighted to welcome you again to Pleasant Hill Community Church for the second of our 2024 concert series concerts. Delighted you are here. We're delighted to be able to offer these free concerts through the year. The last concert we had was in March, and the featured instrument, if you recall, was flute. The next concert in September, September 15, the featured instrument will be clarinet. It's on the program on the bottom on your program. But today the featured instrument is piano, and I'm delighted for that because one of my favorite quotes that I used very often during my ministry, especially in working with churches where there was conflict, and there were a number of those, this particular quotation or citation really was meaningful and helped me. I want to share that with you before we begin. In 1954, Oberlin College, now it was Oberlin College then, in 1954, Oberlin College awarded an honorary degree to Theodore E. Steinway, president of Steinway and Sons, makers of fine pianos. The citation read, "At the time of the centenary last year, the Steinways had produced 342,000 pianos, used and abused, from Liszt to Rubinstein II. In want of the concert grands, 245 strings, taut strings, exert a pull of 40,000 pounds on an iron frame. Theodore E. Steinway gives constant proof that out of great tension can come rich harmony." Isn't that a beautiful, beautiful statement? It's very suggestive, very insightful, very suggestive. But there's two words in that citation that I want to lift up and say back to you. It's not just that a piano is an instrument with those strings and with that pressure, but what it says is gives constant proof that out of great tension can come rich harmony. It doesn't just happen. If I were to sit here and touch those keys, it wouldn't happen. But today we're very fortunate to have a piano virtuoso with us, Josh Davis. Some of you may remember Josh was here with us last September, I believe it was. Oh, here's Josh. Last September, he was the accompanist with Christopher Reams and some students from Tennessee Tech. And that was a delightful concert. But we were able to recognize the individual who was the accompanist and wondered if he couldn't come back for a concert. And we're very glad that he is able to be here and is here with us today. Let me just say a couple of words about Josh. He grew up in Sparta, or did you say Bonaire, really? Sparta, Bonaire, and went to Tennessee Tech. And at Tennessee Tech, he got his master's or his bachelor of music degree in piano performance. And he studied with Dr. Catherine Goods, since age 14. So he's been at this for a while. Then he went to Denver, Colorado, and continued to study there and in Boulder, Colorado. Serves as an adjunct family member now at Tennessee Tech, at the School of Music, College of Fine Arts at Tennessee Tech, where he's a collaborative pianist, accompanist, but also a soloist. We're just delighted to have you back, Josh. This is not a Steinway, but it is a good piano. It's a very good piano, and it's under a lot of pressure, a lot of tension. So we want you to come forward and bring some rich, beautiful harmony to us. Josh.
Thank you. So thank you all, and thank you all for being here, for taking some time out of your Sunday afternoon to come listen to some piano music. I really appreciate it. I'm not going to say much. I never really like it when performers talk at concerts. I'm just kind of like, you know, I didn't come to a lecture. I want to hear the music. I want you to play. But I think this program would benefit from just a little bit of explanation, just a little bit of each piece. So what you just heard was a piece by one of my favorite composers, Franz Liszt, wonderful Hungarian composer of the 19th century. And I always like to open a program with a piece that I'm really comfortable with that I've played for a long time. That piece I've played since I was about 17, so I feel like I can just kind of roll out of bed and play it. So I wanted to open with it to kind of get that out of there. But in my mind, there are sort of two different Liszts. There's this poetic, very spiritual lyrical, meditative list that you just heard, and then there's this much more fiery, tempestuous, virtuosic list, which you'll hear at the very end of the program. I thought, when I was programming this, and I played this recital for the first time last September, this is my second time, I thought, I wonder if it's strange to open and close a recital with list. But I quickly decided I don't really care if it's strange. And I thought it would be a nice contrast to open with two completely different sides of the same open and close with two different sides of the same composer. So next I'm going to play for you a Mozart sonata, which I feel like doesn't need much explanation. It's a Mozart sonata, C major, Kerschel number 330, if you're interested. So here that is. Thank you. don't know if it's hot in here to you guys, but I'm sitting up here sweating at the end of it. So another thing I tend to do when I'm programming is I lean toward all of this dark, serious, brooding music. So for this program, I thought, well, I need something, I could really use something with a little bit of humor, a little bit of lightheartedness. So there it was. Hope you enjoyed it. Now we go back to the dark stuff now. But, so next is a piece. The Mozart Sonata and Scriabin Sonata on this program are so contrasting. I felt like there needed to be some sort of little bridge between the two sonatas. And so the next piece is going to function as a sort of palate cleanser. But I think it's just a really beautiful piece. A friend of mine in Knoxville gave it to me. I discovered it through her. And it's very short, but I fell in love with it. And it's by a composer who doesn't get enough attention. It's R. Nathaniel Dett, wonderful African-American composer of the late 19th, early 20th centuries. One of the prominent composition and piano students of Nadia Boulanger, the American Conservatory in Paris, wonderful composer. But, you know, again, he's been neglected throughout history, probably because just like anyone who wasn't a white man, their compositions were ignored largely. So anyway, this is just a really beautiful piece called Adagio Cantabile. It's a movement from a suite for solo piano called Cinnamon Grove. So here it is. Thank you again. All right, so next up is another one of my favorite composers, Alexander Scriabin. This is his second sonata out of 10 sonatas that he wrote for solo piano. Really interesting composer. Again, I won't bore you with a whole biographical sketch, but if you look at his 10 sonatas for solo piano, they really sort of map out his entire compositional style, because he didn't write all 10 in 1 year or something. They span the entire course of his life. So the first four sonatas are very early, and you hear a lot, well, really the first three are early, and you hear a lot of Chopin influence. A lot of people call early Scriabin Russian Chopin. And then starting with the fifth sonata, he stopped writing in keys altogether, And the music becomes more and more abstract and esoteric the later you go into the sonatas. Scriabin is rumored to, somewhere between the fourth and fifth sonatas, supposedly started experimenting a lot with psychedelic drugs and possibly devil worship. There's a late sonata called The Black Mass, another one called The White Mass. If you're interested, I mean, it's really wild music, so go check it out. But so this is the second sonata. This one is still in a key. and it's the only one of the ten that he describes, or he labels it, a sonata fantasy. So it has two movements instead of the traditional three or four movement sonata form. This one only has two. And Scriabin sort of plays fast and loose with a lot of general rules when it comes to sonata form. So the first movement, again, not to nerd out on you musically, but you know, it's like there are rules for sonata form. Like when the second subject comes back, it has to be in this key, and then in the recap, it's supposed to be in that key. And Scriabin kind of defies a lot of those rules, so I guess he deemed it loosely enough in sonata form that it could be considered a sonata fantasy. The last thing I'll tell you is that, it was inspired by the sea. So the first movement is meant to be this depiction of the mysterious, calm majesty of the sea late at night, and then the second movement is a storm. It's a very difficult storm, so wish me luck when I get there. So here's Scriabin's second sonata in G sharp minor. Thank you. Thank you. Now I'm going to stall while I talk about Lieberman so I can recover from that. All right, two more pieces. So this one, this is one of my favorite living composers, Lowell Lieberman. Still very much active and writing beautiful music as we speak. He just wrote a new flute concerto and a new trio for flute, saxophone, and piano. And his music is really special. I think it's, you know, even though his harmonic language is very progressive, and you'll tell very quickly this is a contemporary piece, but Lieberman hasn't abandoned tonality. That's a point of criticism by a lot of modern composers, is that he clings too tightly to tonality. You know, unlike Scriabin, who stopped writing in keys altogether much earlier than Lieberman was alive. You know, these nocturnes are not really in keys, but they sort of gravitate towards certain tonal areas. So they're very progressive, very abstract. At the very beginning of this nocturne, you would almost think you're listening to a Chopin nocturne, but you're not. And you realize very quickly that it's not Chopin. And every time the melody comes back, it gets just a little bit more esoteric, a little bit more bizarre, if you will. But I love Lieberman's sound world. There's something hauntingly mysterious and sort of darkly beautiful about it all. He writes a lot of long pedals. He likes the pedals sustained for a long time, so you get this blur accumulating in the piano and all these really interesting colors. So here's the fifth nocturne of Lieberman.
Thank you.
Well, Lyle was right. This may not be a Steinway, but it is a gorgeous piano. Lieberman writes four P's at the end of that piece, and I feel like this piano can really whisper that quadruple pianissimo that piece calls for. All right, so here we are, full circle, back at good old Franz Liszt. So, I didn't miss anything on the program. in sharp contrast to the first piece that you heard, the Petrarch Sonnet, this is one of his 12 famous transcendental etudes, which he lists sort of drew inspiration from Chopin with this new 19th century idea that an etude doesn't have to be this mechanical study meant for the practice room to hone in on one technique. It can actually be a beautiful piece meant to be performed on stage. Even though it's still an etude, it's still designed to strengthen one or two particular techniques. They're also beautiful pieces of music that are meant to be played in public and not just exercises for the practice room. So this one in particular is nicknamed the Appassionata. 10 of the 12 etudes list actually gave poetic titles to. This one does not have a title, but it's been nicknamed the Appassionata. You probably see why. It's a very impassioned piece, and it's sort of, the techniques it concentrates on are octaves in the right hand and widely spaced arpeggios flying around the left hand, and also alternating triads. If you're on this side of the room, you'll see my hands in a lot of passages look like this throughout this piece. I'm sort of playing triads on top of each other, which is really tricky. But thank you all again so much for being here. I really appreciate it. And this has been fun. So I hope you enjoy the last piece, which is Liszt's 10th Transcendental Etude. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Josh. On behalf of everybody here, I really just have one word. Wow. Thank you so much. Actually, I also want to do something a little different, maybe. I want to thank you on behalf of the piano. Because I think you helped the piano here to be what it was intended to be and express. And I thank you for on behalf of the piano. Thank all of you for being here. Please take a moment to stop up and say hello to Josh, and thank you to Josh. I want to say to all of you that these are free concerts, but there are containers at each of the exit doors for you. We welcome donations to help us to maintain the ability to have these concerts. And also, you'll find there, if you don't already have one, you have a little card we'd like you to fill out with your name and your email address and drop it in the donation box, and we will see that you get emails regarding future concerts, the times, the intentions, and so on. And we promise to use it only for that purpose. We won't use it for anything else. But there are cards like this, and they're at the doors. Thank you all so much for coming, and thanks again, Josh. Really, really.